And that was Escape by Journey. This is DJ Eric. It is now 10 o'clock, and this is the start of Broadway Fridays. Welcome back, everybody. And continuing what I've been doing, well, just last week and now this week, and again next week, unfortunately, due to personal stuff, had to cut this this particular month a little bit short, I guess. I'm continuing on with my tribute to Stephen Sondheim, and it's kind of apt that I chose to do this show today because this show got its start at the Old Globe Theater in San Diego in 1986. Today we are doing Into the Woods, which is probably one of my three favorite shows, definitely. I mean, at the moment, top favorite is Hamilton because it's kind of like a culmination of everything that I find enjoyable about music. But when it comes to nostalgia, when it comes to things that first got me into musicals, Into the Woods is definitely the top on that list. It's one of the first shows that I saw live. It's one of the first shows that I was really taught about, you know, look at the music, look at the lyrics, look at how everything is interweaving and the story that it makes. And, yeah, I just found it amazing. So this show premiered, as I said, at the Old Globe Theater in 1986 and premiered on Broadway November 5th, 1987. Now, here's something that's just kind of crazy, or that shows you how good this is. This was the same year that the first big revival of Phantom of the Opera came out. Phantom of the Opera's first big revival was in 1986, and it was a huge, huge deal. It took all of the Tonys. It took, you know, it won so many things. But Into the Woods, the year that it came out, in a year that was just owned by Phantom of the Opera, it got three Tony Awards for Best Score, which just goes to show that, yes, Stephen Sondheim is much better than Andrew Lloyd Webber. I will fight you on this. For Best Book, Lyrics, better than Andrew Lloyd Webber's.
Mm-hmm.
And Best Leading Actress with Joanna Gleason as the Baker's Wife. Now, this show is much more like Hamilton in that most of the action takes place in the music. So there's not a lot of stuff that I'm going to have to be recapping in between the tracks. But I am going to be looking back, doing some commentary, doing some examinations of these different pieces and what it is that everyone's saying, what it is they're meaning. Sometimes the meanings are fairly obvious, sometimes they're not. But I am going to shut up, I'm going to sit back, and I'm going to let the narrator, the baker and his wife, Cinderella, and the poor farmer's boy, take it away.
Once upon a time,
I wish,
in a far-off kingdom,
more than anything,
lived a fair maiden,
life,
a sad young lad,
I wish,
and a childless baker.
More than life,
I wish,
with his
more
wife,
more than anything,
more than the moon,
I wish,
the king is giving a festival.
More than life,
I wish
to go to the festival.
More than riches,
I wish my cow would give us some milk.
More than anything,
I wish we had a child.
Squeeze, pal, squeeze, pal.
I wish to go to the festival.
I wish you'd give us some milk.
I
have
a child.
I
wish. You wish to go to the festival?
The poor girl's mother had died.
You, Cinderella, the festival.
What?
You wish to go to the festival? The festival, the king's festival.
And her father had taken for his new wife
festival.
A woman with two daughters of her own.
Look at your nails.
Look at your dress. People would laugh at you. Nevertheless,
she still wants to go to the festival and dance before the prince.
All three were beautiful of face, but vile and black of heart. Jack, on the other hand, had no father, and his mother,
I wish,
well, she was not quite beautiful.
I wish my son were not a fool. I wish my house was not a mess. I wish the cow was full of milk. I wish the walls were full of gold. I wish a lot of things.
Why, come in, little girl.
I wish it's not for me, it's for my granny in the woods. A loaf of bread, please, to bring my poor old hungry granny in the woods. Just a loaf. loaf of bread, please.
Cinderella's stepmother had a surprise for her.
I have emptied a pot of lentils into the ashes for you. If you have picked them out again in 2 hours' time, you shall go to the ball with us.
And perhaps a sticky bun or four.
Birds in the sky, birds in the eaves and the leaves and the fields and the castles and the ponds.
And a few of those ponds.
Down from the eaves and the leaves, over fields, out of castles and ponds.
No squeeze.
Son, milky white must be taken to market.
But mother, no! He's the best cow.
Look at her! There are bugs on her dugs. There are flies in her eyes. There's a lump on her rump big enough to be a hump.
But
son, we've no time to sit and dither while her withers wither with her. And no one keeps a cow for a friend. Sometimes I fear you're touched.
Into the woods it's time to go. I hate to leave, I have to though. Into the woods it's time, and so I must begin my journey. Into the woods and through the trees to where I am expected, ma'am. Into the woods to grandmother's house. Into the woods to grandmother's house.
You're certain of your way?
The way is clear, the light is good. I have no fear, nor no one should. The woods are just trees, the trees are just wood. Hate to ask it, but do you have a basket? Into the woods and down the dell, the path is straight, I know it well. Into the woods and who can tell what's waiting on the journey? Into the woods to bring some bread to Granny who is sick in bed. Never can tell what lies ahead, for all that I know she's already dead. But into the woods, to grandmother's house and home before dark.
Can't you hide it with a hat?
You look beautiful.
I know.
She means me.
Put it in a twist.
Who will be there?
Mother said be good. Father said be nice. That was always their advice. So be nice.
I'm good, Cinderella.
Nice, good,
and tighter.
What's the good of being good if everyone is blind and you're always up behind? Never mind, Cinderella. Kind, Cinderella. Nice, good, nice, kind, good.
No! Not that tight. Claude. Who might that be?
It's the witch from next door.
The old enchantress told the couple she had placed a spell on their house.
What spell?
In the past, when your mother was with child, she developed an unusual appetite. She took one look at my beautiful garden and told your father that what she wanted more than anything in the world was greens, greens, and nothing but greens. Parsley, peppers, cabbages, and celery, asparagus, and watercress, and vittlebers, and lettuce. He said, all right, but it wasn't quite.
'Cause I caught him in the autumn in my garden one night. He was robbing me, raping me,
rooting through my rutabaga, raiding my arugula, and ripping up the rampy and my champion and my banner, and I should have laid a spell on him right there.
Could have turned him into stone. Or a dog, or a chair.
But I let him have the rampion, and I'd lots to spare. In return, however, I said, fair is fair. You can let me have the baby that your wife will bear. And we'll call it square.
I had a brother?
No. But you had a sister.
But the witch refused to tell him any more of his sister. Not even that her name was Rapunzel.
I thought I had been more than reasonable. But how was I to know what your father had also hidden in his pocket?
What?
Beans!
Beans!
The special beans! I let him go, I didn't know he stole my beans! I was watching him crawl back over the wall, then bang, crash, the lightning flash! And well, that's another story, never mind. Anyway, at last the big day came, I made my claim. Oh, don't take away the baby, they
son.
That your family tree would always be a barren one. So, there's no more fuss and there's no more scenes in my garden thrones. You should see my nectarines, but I'm telling you the same I tell kings and queens. You'll never, never, ever mess around with my greens. Especially the beans. Now listen to me, Jack. Lead Milky White to market and fetch the best price you can. Are you listening to me? Jack, 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 head in a sack. The house is getting colder. This is not a time for dreaming. Chimney stack starting to crack. The mice are getting bolder. The floor's gone slack. Your mother's getting older. Your father's not back. And you can't just sit here dreaming pretty dreams. To wish and wait from day to day will never keep the wolves away. So into the woods, the time is now. We have to live, I don't care how. Into the woods to sell the cow, you must begin the journey. Straight through the woods and don't delay, we have to face the marketplace. Into the woods to journey's end.
Into the woods to sell a friend.
Meanwhile, the witch, for purposes of her own, explained how the baker might lift the spell.
You wish to have the curse reversed? I'll need a certain potion first. Go to the wood and bring me back. One, the cow as white as milk. Two, the cape as red as blood. Three, the hair as yellow as corn. Four, the slipper as pure as gold. Bring me these before the time of midnight. In 3 days' time, and you shall have, I guarantee, a child as perfect as child can be. Go to the wood!
Ladies! Our carriage waits!
Now may I go to the festival?
The festival? Darning those nails, darning those clothes, lentils are one thing, but darning with those should make us the fools of the festival, and mortify the prince!
The carriage is waiting!
We must be gone!
I wish.
Look what I found in Father's hunting jacket.
6 beans. We'll take them with us.
No, the spell is on my house. Only I can lift the spell.
No, the spell is on
my house.
On our house.
No,
we must lift
the
spell.
You are not to come, and that is final. Now, what am I to return with?
You don't remember? The cow is white as milk, the cape is red as blood, the hair is yellow as corn, the slipper is pure as gold.
The cow is white as milk, the cape is red.
And so the baker reluctantly set off to meet the enchantress's demands. As for Cinderella,
I still wish to go to the festival.
The cow is white as milk,
but how am I ever to get to
the
festival? I know I'll visit Father's grave, as maybe the kids will be. And how am I to wonder if the king's festival?
Just the prologue. Well, during that, of course, we have met all of the principal characters. We've got the baker and his wife, who are, you know, wanting to have a child. We've got the witch, who is keeping them from having a child. We've got Jack, who is supposed to go and sell his cow, but doesn't want to, and Jack's mom, who is making him sell the cow. We've got Little Red Riding Hood, who is skipping off into the woods on her own, and we have Cinderella, who is, of course, being tormented by her step-siblings and her stepmother. The way that Sondheim has merged all of these stories together and put them into a single narrative is something that, at the time, was fairly unique. You know, nowadays, it's almost a given that if you're going to tell a fairy tale story, you're not just going to tell one fairy tale story, you're going to tell all of them. I mean, look at Once Upon a Time, look at Gallivant, look at so many other, you know, books, comic books, movies, TV shows that have started to look at these characters, and basically they just decide, no, we can't just do the one thing, we have to do everything. But when Sondheim was doing it, he was like, no. He was like, these characters are all together. They all exist in the same kingdom. They all probably are right down the road from each other. They can talk to each other. And they're definitely all outside of the same set of woods, which is the place where all of them have to go to find the things that they need. So, don't know if you caught it. It was kind of difficult to discern, but Cinderella has decided that the way that she is going to get what she needs is to visit her mother's grave. Unfortunately, there is no fairy godmother in this version. However, Cinderella's mother fulfills that role.
Cinderella had planted a branch at the grave of her mother, and her many tears watered it until it had become a handsome tree.
I've been good and I've been kind, Mother, doing only what I learned from you. Why then am I left behind, Mother? Is there something more that I should do? What is wrong with me, Mother? Something must be wrong. I wish.
Do you know what you wish? Are you certain what you wish is what you want? If you know what you want, then make a wish. Ask the tree, and you shall have your wish.
Shiver and quiver, little tree. Silver and gold, throw down on me. I'm off to get my wish.
And what obviously you can't see there is right around then a bunch of birds descend from the sky, bringing down a lovely gown and pair of shoes for Cinderella to wear to the ball. Like I said, no fairy godmother, no magical mice, no transformations in this one. But, you know, they were doing a Broadway show. There's only so much that they can do. Next, we pick up with Little Red Riding Hood as she is heading through the forest. And she meets a character who takes on a much more unsavory tone in this particular version.
Good day, young lady.
Good day, Mr. Wolf.
Look at the flesh, pink and plump. Hello, little girl. Tender and fresh, not one lump. Hello, little girl. This one's especially lush, delicious. Hello, little girl, what's your rush? You're missing all the flowers. The sun won't set for hours. Take your time.
Mother said straight ahead, not to delay or be misled.
But slow, little girl, hark and hush. The birds are singing sweetly. You'll miss the birds completely. You're traveling so fleetly. Grandmother first, then Miss Plump. What a delectable couple. Ah, to perfection, one brittle, one supple, one moment,
Mother,
my dear.
May fall the path and never stray.
Just so, little girl, any path, so many worth exploring. Just one would be so boring. And look what you're ignoring. Think of those crisp, aging bones, and something fresh on the palate. Think of that scrumptious carnality twice in one day. There's no possible way to describe what you feel when you're talking to your meal.
Mother said not to stray, still I suppose a small delay. Granny might like a fresh bouquet. Goodbye, Mr. Wolf.
Goodbye, little girl. And hello.
So I'm fairly certain that the symbolism and the word choice that was used there was obvious, but in case it wasn't, yeah, the wolf in this instance is being portrayed as a sexual predator. You know, talking about experiencing a scrumptious carnality, the way that he describes Red Riding Hood, it's not subtle at all, but it is kind of interesting that that Sondheim chose to do that with the with the text of the show, that he decided, he made the conscious decision that instead of portraying it more more traditionally as, you know, this is a wolf, this is something that's going to eat you. No. He went with the metaphor. He went with, usually, you know, wolves, werewolf-type creatures in mythology and in folklore are used to represent, like, an animalistic loss of control of people. And so when he was putting the wolf into the woods, he was like, this is what I'm going to choose to have this thing be. And I'm going to try to make it as unsubtle as I possibly can without him just coming out and saying, I'm going to rape her. And if you see the show, it's much more obvious because the wolf's naked. I'm just going to say it. The wolf's naked. I mean, he is completely nude. He has his genitals out on display. To make this clear, it is not a nude actor on the show. It is a guy in a wolf costume, but he has very clearly depicted genitals, and his dancing, his blocking, his choreography for the show usually consists of him hip thrusting all over the stage. It's obvious what they're doing. You know, they're not trying to hide it. They're not trying to be subtle about it. They're coming out and saying the wolf is a sexual predator. Now, in the version that came out 2 years ago that Disney made, they did something that was a little bit different. In most versions of the show, Red Riding Hood is depicted. There's two children characters in the main parts. You know, there's the four main characters, quote unquote main characters. There's the baker and his wife, who are adults. There's Cinderella, who is supposed to be at least late teens or early 20s, depending on what interpretation you're going with. And then there's Red Riding Hood and the farm boy. And usually what they do is they make the farm boy a little bit older, so it's kind of obvious that he's just dumb. You know, that's why his mother is worried about him. She's like, yeah, you're supposed to be a man, but you're clearly an idiot, so I still have to take care of you and explain to you things like, stop calling your female cow a guy because she's a girl, she gives milk, just take her to town and sell her. God, you're dumb. And Riding Hood is younger, kind of to play up the very creepy and unsettling sexual attraction aspect or sexual predation aspect that the wolf has going on towards her. In the movie, they reversed that. They made Jack much younger. Like, he's barely out of his into double digits. And when you've got a kid that's barely in double digits and you've got the mom saying, take responsibility, be the man of the house, go sell this cow that's your friend, it's like, he's a kid. He's 10 years old. I realize that this is fairy tale times and medieval times, but this is still, he's still a kid. Why are you being so awful to him? But at the same time, they upped the age of Red Riding Hood. They made her closer to what Cinderella's age is supposed to be. And I'm not going to get into any type of consent or victim blaming thing or anything like that, but it does throw off the dynamic of the characters a little bit. You know, you have a character who is supposed to, who is normally perceived as much younger, suddenly now being perceived as much older. And I don't know, it's one of the reasons, it was one of the choices that Disney made with that film that struck me as very odd. And, you know, I would have loved to have known why they did that. So speaking of Jack, he has gotten to the point where he is going to be selling his beloved milky white cow. And it's time for him to say goodbye to her.
And the baker gave Jack 5 beans in exchange for his cow, keeping 1 for himself.
I guess this is goodbye, old pal. You've been a perfect friend. I hate to see us part, old pal. Someday I'll buy you back. I'll see you soon again. I hope that when I do, it won't be on a plate.
Magic beans.
No one would have given him more for this creature.
Are we to dispel this curse through deceit?
If you know what you want, then you go and you find it and you get it.
Home.
Do we want a child or not? And you give and you take and you bid and you bargain or you live to regret it.
Will you please go home?
There are rights and wrongs and in-betweens. No one waits when fortune intervenes. And maybe they're really magic. Who knows? Why you do what you do, that's the point. All the rest of it is chatter.
Look at her, she's crying.
If the thing you do is pure in intent, if it's meant and it's just a little bent, does it matter?
Yes.
No, what matters is that everyone tells tiny lies. What's important really is the size. Only 3 more tries and we'll have our prize. When the end's in sight, you'll realize. If the end is right, it justifies the beat.
Little thing that I forgot to mention before, mainly because I mistakenly remembered that all of the music from the show is in the, or I mistakenly thought that all the music from the show is in the soundtrack. Unfortunately, it's not. There's a number of little interstitial bits that are missed over. One of them was a bit of a reprise of the baker and his wife's song from the prologue, The Spell Is on My House, where as he is getting ready to leave, the baker finds that there are 5 beans in the traveling cloak that his father left him, which, not sure if you caught that, but that was what his father basically caused his father to have the curse put on his house. So he found the beans and he managed to trick Jack, this, you know, idiot boy or child, depending on which version that you're looking at, managed to trick Jack into giving his beloved cow up for 5 magical beans. Now, here's where we start to see some very interesting characterization. The baker is much more focused on being truthful. He doesn't want to do the same things that his father did. He doesn't want to be his father because, you know, as far as he knows, his father just vanished when he was a child, and he doesn't want to follow that same path. And now he found out that the reason that his father vanished is because he was a thief. And he's like, I really don't want to be him. I don't want to do the same things that he did. And now he's lying to get what he wants. And so he's thinking, how is that making me any different from my father? However, his wife is telling him, no, We can lie. That's totally fine. Everybody lies. The only thing that matters is how big the lie is. We have to, this is what we need to do in order to get what we want. And you do still want this, don't you? You still want this child. So we're already seeing that there's going to, that the wife is willing to compromise morally to get what she wants, whereas the baker is more, is wanting to follow a more moralistic path. I think that that's a very, that that's a very interesting interplay between the two of them. Coming up, so Jack has given up the, Jack has given up his lovely cow, which, if you remember the ingredients that the witch told her, or told the baker and his wife to get, a cow as white as milk, a cloak as red as blood, a slipper as pure as gold, a slipper as pure as gold, and hair as yellow as corn. So, we already know that the white cow is from Jack. Pretty sure that they met a little girl who had a blood red cloak, who they're going into the woods to try to find. Hair as yellow as corn, not sure where that could come from yet, but slipper as pure as gold. I think that there's another character around who's got that going, or who has that going on. But as a little bit of a side tour, the baker has gone to, or the baker went to try to find Little Red Riding Hood, and instead he found that Riding Hood had already been devoured along with her grandmother by the wolf. And so he comes in and slices the grandmother and Little Red out of the wolf's stomach. And Little Red is now reflecting upon the different things that she has learned in her time in the woods.
Mother said, straight ahead, not to delay or be misled. I should have heeded her advice, but he seemed so nice. And he showed me things, many beautiful things that I hadn't thought to explore. They were off my path, so I never had dared. I had been so careful, I never had cared. And he made me feel excited, well, excited and scared. When he said, come in, with that sickening grin, how could I know what was in store? Once his teeth were bare, though I really got scared, well, excited and scared, but he drew me close, and he swallowed me down, down a dark, slimy path, where lie secrets that I never want to know. And when everything familiar seemed to disappear forever at the end of the path.
No knot unties itself.
Sometimes the things you most wish for are not to be touched.
The harder to get, the better to have.
Never wear a open
The difference between a cow and a bean is a bean can begin an adventure.
Slotted spoons don't hold much soup.
The prettier the flower, the farther from the path.
The closer to the family, the closer to the wine. A servant is not just a dog to a prince.
Opportunity is not a lengthy visit.
You may know what you need, but to get what you want, better see that you keep what you have.
One midnight gone.
Sometimes I think you're most wishful.
The harder to get, the better to have.
My touch.
To get what you want,
the prettier the flower. One midnight gone.
One midnight gone. Into the woods. Into the woods. Into the woods. Then out of the woods and home before.
There are giants in the sky. There are big, tall, terrible giants in the sky. When you're way up high and you look below at the world you left and the things you know, little more than a glance is enough to show you just how small you are. When you're way up high and you're on your own in a world like none that you've ever known, where the sky is lead and the earth is stone, you're free to do whatever pleases you. Exploring things you'd never dare, cause you don't care when suddenly there's a big, tall, terrible giant at the door. A big, tall, terrible lady giant sweeping the floor. And she gives you food and she gives you rest, and she draws you close to her giant breast, and you know things now that you never knew before. Not till the sky Only just when you've made a friend and all, and you know she's big, but you don't feel small. Someone bigger than her comes along the hall to swallow you for lunch. And your heart is lead and your stomach's stone, and you're really scared being all alone. And it's then that you miss all the things you've known, and the world you left, and the little you own. The fun is done, you steal what you can and run. And you scramble down and you look below, and the world you know begins to grow. The roof, the house, and your mother at the door. The roof, the house, and the world you never thought to explore. And you think of all of the things you've seen, and you wish that you could live in between. And you're back again, only different than before. After the sky, there are giants in the sky. There are big, tall, terrible, awesome, scary, wonderful giants in the sky.
And just there, you saw another reason that Jack is usually much older in the stage show, and another reason I think that Disney made a screw up when they did the movie version. It takes a voice that's matured to hit those notes. I mean, God, I'm just remembering when the kid did that. I've got the film version on here, but I'm not going to subject anybody to that. That's just, oh God, that kid's voice is painful. But anyways, to catch up on some stuff, had to take a bit of a break, obviously, because we had a newscast to do. Thank you, Ryan. So after Little Red Riding Hood decided that she was going to give the baker her red cloak and reflected on all of the things that she had experienced in, you know, the wolf's stomach, Jack's mother found that he had beans instead of, you know, money from selling off the cow, and she got pissed off and she threw the beans away, and then a very large beanstalk grew. I'm sure you can see where all this is going. Cinderella is also running away from the ball at the end of the first night, being pursued by the very, very handsome prince and his steward, but the baker's wife finds her and helps her hide. There's a moment where it seems like the baker, or like the prince, is noticing the baker's wife because, well, you know, she's gorgeous, especially in the stage musical. She's played by Joanna Gleason. In the movie version, she's played by Emily Blunt, so yeah, the baker's wife is usually just amazing looking. But he notices her for a second, but then runs past in the direction that she says the beautiful woman went, and the two of them talk about the ball that she was just at, with the baker's wife lamenting that she has not been able to go to the ball and what she thinks it's like. And again, we see that level of moral compromise. She's like, she's wanting all of these things. She's wanting, you know, the fancy life. She's wanting the things that she doesn't have. Which is a really basically what this show is all about. This show is about these fairy tales and people getting what they want. And what is it that they really want? But anyways, as she stands up and sees the giant beanstalk growing, the baker's wife notices that Cinderella's slippers are pure gold, and she tries to get them, but unfortunately Milky White runs away. And there we have the first midnight as the different characters come out and shout credos and morals and, you know, little things that they've learned both on and off stage. I apologize for some of that. The recording just isn't all that good in some of those instances. The people weren't properly mic'd, or that just wasn't picked up that well from the performance. So there were some of them that were very faint, but the ones that were important were the ones that were fairly clear. And then Jack comes down and describes, you know, as he just did, what happened when he found the giants in the sky. So he stole a bit of gold from them, and he finds the baker, and he's giving the baker 5 gold pieces, because he's like, if I give you 5 gold pieces, I can get my cow back, right? And then the baker says, but I don't know. And Jack's like, I can get more. Wait. And he runs back to climb back up the mount, or the beanstalk, to get more gold from the giants. Then the baker and his wife meet up, and the baker's wife confesses that she's lost the cow, and she and the baker just get into an argument and then split apart to go and try to find it. Now, however, the prince who is chasing Cinderella meets up with his brother, another prince, to create one of the truly perfect songs. And one of the only ways in which I honestly believe that the movie surpassed the musical is because as great and as hammy and as over the top as this song is, I want you to try to imagine it being performed by Captain Kirk wearing Renaissance Fair gear under a waterfall. Yeah. It's just, it's unspeakable, isn't it?
Did I abuse her or show her disdain? Why does she run from me? If I should lose her, how shall I regain the heart she has won from me? Agony beyond power of speech, when the one thing you want is the only thing out of your reach. High in her tower, she sits by the hour, maintaining her hair. Blithe and becoming, I'm frequently humming a light-hearted air. Agony far more painful than yours, when you know she would go with you if there only were doors. Agony, all the torture they teach. What's as intriguing or half so fatiguing as what's out of reach? Am I not sensitive, clever, well-mannered, considerate, passionate, charming, as kind as I'm handsome and heir to a throne?
You are everything maidens could wish for.
Then why no?
Why no?
You must be mad.
You know nothing of madness till you're climbing her hair, and you see her up there as you're nearing her, all the while hearing her agony, misery, though it's different for each. Always 10 steps behind,
always 10 feet below,
and she's just out of reach.
Agony
that can cut like a knife. I must have her to one.
And the princes, the two charming princes, decide that they must have these women. And so they make a pact that they are going to get them. As, you know, many men in, or many guys in these types of situations seem to. But as the baker's wife, who has been eavesdropping on the whole thing, she notices that when the other prince, not the one that was following Cinderella, but the other one, mentions a woman in a tower with hair as yellow as corn, she's like, oh, so that's where I can get it. And so she decides to run to the Tower of Rapunzel and get her to let down her hair, and then she pulls it off of her. Like, in the show, she doesn't even have a knife or a pair of scissors or anything. She just says, let down your hair, and grabs the hair and just yanks until she gets it to just fall off of her head. It's a little weird. I mean, you'd think that she'd basically scalp her if that was going to happen, but no, she just yanks it and it cuts off right at ponytail length. And then she runs away with the long hair as yellow as corn. And then the baker manages to find Milky White. So now they have the items again, and so the baker and his wife. Or the baker managed to run into Cinderella again as she is leaving the party towards the end of the second night. And the baker's wife tries to grab Cinderella's shoes, but Cinderella gets away. And now, then the baker finds his wife, and they sit and they talk, and they're trying to they're trying to cheer each other up over everything that has happened and how close they are, because there's one midnight to go and they have most of the objects.
You've changed. You're daring. You're different in the woods. More sure, more sharing. You're getting us through the woods. If you could see, you're not the man who started, and much more open-hearted than I knew you to be.
It takes two. I thought one was enough. It's not true. It takes two of us. You came through. When the journey was rough, it took you. It took two of us. It takes care. It takes patience and fear and despair to change, though you swear to change. Who can tell if you do? It takes two.
You've changed. You're thriving. There's something about the woods. Not just surviving. You're blossoming in the woods. At home, I'd fear we'd stay the same forever. And then, out here, you're passionate, charming, considerate, clever.
It takes one to begin, but then once you've begun, it takes two of you. It's no fun, but what needs to be done, you can do. When there's two of you, if I dare, it's because I'm becoming aware of us as a pair of us, each accepting a share of what's there.
We've changed, we're strangers. I'm meeting you in the woods. Who might? What dangers? I know we'll get past the woods. And once we're past, let's hope the changes last. Beyond woods, beyond witches and slippers and hoods, just the two of us, beyond lies, safe at home with our beautiful prize. Just a few of us.
It takes trust. It takes just a bit more, and we're done. We want four, we have none, we've got three. We need one. It takes two.
Another one of my favorite songs from this show. In fact, it was so much one of my favorites that I put it in my wedding. Yes, yes, I know, I am a dork. That's fine. But one of the things I like about that song is it looks at the changing nature of relationships. It's, you know, the baker's wife had only seen him as a very stable, very staid individual, somebody who was, like, reliable, who she could rely on for security, for, you know, so many different things. But now that they're in the woods, now that they're on this adventure, now that there's things that are happening, she's seeing him in a much different light. She's seeing him much more as, this is, you are a hero. You are somebody who is willing to sacrifice, who's willing to put everything on the line for us to get what we want, for us to get our family. And that's changing how I'm seeing you. That's changing how I'm relating to you. And I like it because it speaks to the nature of relationships. You know, as you go through the course of a relationship, things change. You know, your feelings towards one another change, your feelings towards your life change, your feelings towards pretty much everything are going to change. And you have to be able to accept that. You have to be able to accept the good and the bad. You have to be able to look at everything about your life and about your relationship and say, you know, is this something that I still want? Is this something I still need going forward? And you need to be able to deal with that and not just deny that it isn't happening. And I think that the show very much, you know, illustrates that in a very good way, that, you know, they're looking at the good, they're looking at the bad. At least, you know, that's my interpretation of it. I'm sure that that's not what everybody's is, but anyways. So a whole bunch of other stuff is happening, obviously. Jack comes down from the beanstalk, carrying the hen that lays golden eggs, trying to again buy Milky White back. And unfortunately, the cow just keels over and dies right when he does that. So, sorry, Jack. Your friend is dead. And sorry to the baker and his wife, because they're now missing one of their ingredients. And another one of the songs that unfortunately isn't in here, it's a little bit short, but it's really good, is the second midnight, as all of the characters come out and lament the passing of time, the fact that their deadlines are getting closer and they aren't closer to getting what they need. And in some cases, they're closer to losing everything that they have, because the witch discovers that the prince has been visiting Rapunzel, and she wants, you know, she's had this child with her for however many years she's had her, and she wants her to stay with her. She wants to keep her safe. She wants to keep her, you know, keep her in a place where she can control her and keep her pure and keep her away from all of the evils of the world. But she can't, and she realizes that. But she doesn't deal with it as well as some people should, or as some people do.
What did I clearly say? Children should listen.
No, no, please.
What were you not to do? Children must see.
No.
And learn. Why could you not obey? Children should listen. What have I been to you? What would you have me be? Handsome like a prince. Oh, but I am old, I am ugly, I embarrass you.
No.
You are ashamed of me.
No.
You are ashamed.
You don't understand.
It was lonely atop that tower.
I was not company enough.
I am no longer a child. I wish to see the world.
Don't you know what's out there in the world? Someone has to shield you from the world. Stay with me. Princes wait there in the world, it's true. Princes, yes, but more than humans too. Stay at home. I am home. Mother could love you more than I. What out there?
And we find out now what it is that the witch wants. She wants her daughter. She wants the girl that she's raised to stay with her and continue to love her. And it's kind of an interesting take on toxic relationships, because, you know, there are so many parents out there that refuse to believe that their children can grow up in any way, either, you know, emotionally, physically, mentally, that they'll always need to have their parents with them, but they refuse to think that kids are more resilient and kids are more capable than that. And bad things tend to happen when you start thinking that. But anyway, sorry, I'm rambling. I apologize for that. Sometimes my thoughts don't go together as well as they should. comes from doing most of this stuff off the cuff. I should probably write these things down before I start out. Anyways, unfortunately, at the end of this song, Rapunzel has refused to stay with the witch, and so she slices off the rest of Rapunzel's hair and banishes her to the desert. Not sure where a desert is near this, you know, incredibly verdant European kingdom that all this action has been happening in, but I can only imagine that it's, you know, somewhere down in Italy, which is just very weird that it's like, okay, we're England, Germany, someplace up there, and go down to Italy, be in the desert. What? Why? Just go down there. Okay. The baker gets some money to try to buy another cow that he's going to pass off as being Milky White, and Jack meets up with Little Red Riding Hood, who is sporting a wolf cape and also carrying around a knife that she's just brandishing at people and saying, "Stay back or I'll cut you." He tries to impress her by telling her the stories of the Kingdom of the Giants, when she says, "Oh yeah, right, sure, yeah, you climbed up and saw a giant." Mm-hmm. He says, "All right, I'll prove it to you. I will go back up there and I will steal the giant's magic harp." So keep in mind, he stole some gold, he stole the hen, and now he's going back up to steal a harp. Not sure. Pretty sure that this is going to end badly for everybody. But Cinderella is, the next time that we see Cinderella, right now actually, she is coming out of her final night of the festival, her final night in the at the ball dancing with the prince. And she has been running away trying to get away from the prince before he could find out her identity. However, she finds out that this time the prince has planned for this.
He's a very smart prince. He's a prince who prepares. Knowing this time I'd run from him, he spread pitch on the stairs. I was caught unawares, and I thought, well, he cares. This is more than just malice. Better stop and take stock while you're standing here stuck on the steps of the palace. You think, what do you want? You think, make a decision. Why not stay and be caught? You think, well, it's a thought. What would be his response? But then what if he knew who you were, when you know that you're not what he thinks that he wants? And then what if you are what a prince would envision? Although how can you know who you are till you know what you want, what you don't? So then which do you pick, where you're safe out of sight and yourself, but where everything's wrong? Or where everything's right and you know that you'll never be long? And whichever you pick, do it quick, 'cause you're starting to stick to the steps of the palace. It's your first big decision. The choice isn't easy to make. To arrive at a ball is exciting and all. Once you're there, though, it's scary. And it's fun to deceive when you know you can leave, but you have to be wary. There's a lot that's at stake, but you've stalled long enough, 'cause you're still standing stuck in the stuff on the steps. Better run along home and avoid the collision. Even though they don't care, you'll be better off there, where there's nothing to choose, so there's nothing to lose. So you pry up your shoes, then from out of the blue, and without any guide, you know what your decision is, which is not to decide. You'll just leave him a clue, for example, a shoe, and then see what he'll do. Now it's he and not you who is stuck with a shoe in a stew, in the goo. And you've learned something too, something you never knew, on the steps of the palace.
Like I said, the show is a lot about what you want. What is it that the characters in it want? What is it that getting what you, realizing what it is that you want and getting what you want, how it affects you? And, you know, here Cinderella technically, like, she doesn't have the magical reasons for not being able to stick around after midnight that she does in, in the fairy tales. In this, she's basically leaving at midnight just because she doesn't want to stay later. She wants to have this as a brief moment that she goes to outside of being in, outside of being involved in her regular life. Obviously, she doesn't really like her regular life all that much. You know, she's being horribly abused by her stepmother and her stepsisters, but she's also afraid of what it's going to mean if she throws herself wholeheartedly into being, you know, into going with the prince. It's, you know, it's understandable. It's like, you're going to give me what I want. Well, how do I know what I want? How do I know that this is, that this thing that I'm asking for is something that is going to be good for me? I should just go back to, you know, this place, even though it's scary and even though it's awful and even though it hurts me, I'm used to it. It's familiar. I know what to expect there. Here, it might be better, but it might be so much worse. So I'm not going to commit to it fully. But anyways, as she runs away with the one shoe missing, the baker's wife has managed to find her and gets her to give her other shoe, offering the final magic bean in exchange for it. And Cinderella gives the shoe over, looks at the bean, and decides, meh, whatever, tosses the bean away, and trades the, gives the shoe to the baker's wife. I think I already said that. Not sure. Then the baker and his wife meet up, and now they have all four of the cows. The prince's steward, of course, is running through the woods trying to find Cinderella, and when he sees the slipper with the baker's wife, he grabs it and tries to wrestle it away from her, and then there is a huge crash that shocks everybody, and then Jack's mother comes in to say that a giant is seeking revenge on Jack for stealing his magic harp, but he has fallen from the beanstalk when Jack chopped it down and is dead in her backyard. So she basically runs in, looks at the prince's steward and says, I have a dead giant in my backyard and you need to deal with it. And the steward is like, not my department, bye. And tries to run off. However, the prince is much more concerned with finding Cinderella, and takes off with the one slipper that he had that was covered in pitch and leaves the other one with the baker and his wife. Jack, to the relief of his mother, comes back in with the magic harp saying, I survived, Mom, look. And the witch comes in and says, do you have all of the ingredients? They say, yes, we've got everything. And they push all of the ingredients forward. And then the witch touches the cow that they bring out and realizes the cow is covered in flour. It's like, this cow is brown. It is not white. The baker says, I all these things happened and we had a white cow, but it died. And then the witch comes and revives the cow, basically says, take me to where the dead cow is. And she works her magic and the cow comes back to life. It's like, oh, okay, now we have the white cow. So they feed the cow all of the ingredients, like, you know, a cloak and hair and a shoe. That makes no sense at all. But, okay, it's a fairy tale. So they feed him to her, and unfortunately, or then they get the milk out of the cow, or they try to get the milk out, and nothing comes. Nothing comes out of the cow, and they're, like, squeezing the udders, and they're saying, what's going on? Why isn't this working? And then the witch asks, where did you get these ingredients? And the baker's wife says, well, we got the slippers from this girl that was running through the woods. We got the cape from this other girl that we cut out of a wolf. We got the cow from this guy. And we got the hair from this girl in a tower. And the witch goes, ah, I wasn't supposed to touch any of these ingredients. I touched this. Now it won't work. None of this will work. And then the baker decides, wait. I've got corn. And he actually pulls out some corn from his pouch, and he's got corn silk on there. And so he takes the silk from the corn and feeds that to the cow. And that works. I promise you, it is so much better than what I'm making it sound like. But anyways, they get the cow to give milk. The witch drinks the milk, and she turns from being a hideous hag witch into being, depending on which version you're watching, Bernadette Peters or Meryl Streep. Personally, I prefer the Bernadette Peters version, but that's just me. The witch drinks the milk, she transforms, and she's like, ah, finally, I'm a beautiful young woman. And apparently that was what that was what happened when the baker stole the beans, was she was cursed to be this older, you know, when she said there was a crash and a bang and all this stuff came, but that's another story, never mind. The other story was that she was supposed to be, you know, young and beautiful forever, and instead got turned into an old hag. Now that this has gotten to the end of the first act, Cinderella's prince manages to find her. The stepsisters try to get the shoe to fit on their feet, and sticking very closely to the original story, the stepsisters slice off pieces of their feet in order to try to get the shoe to fit. But the prince notices that you're walking with a limp, my new bride, who has just put her foot into my shoe, or into the shoe. Why are you walking with the... Oh, God, there's so much blood. There is so much blood in these slippers. And unfortunately for them, but fortunately for Cinderella, he manages to find her, get the shoe on her, and take her to wife. Rapunzel comes out of the desert where the prince finds her. The witch finds the couple and attempts to curse them, only to find that as a price of the magic, or of her getting back her youth, she's lost all of her magical powers. So she can't curse anybody else anymore. Darn. And after this, there is a big wedding at the end, and we have the happily ever after, which, of course, this being a Broadway musical, everyone will sing about.
And it came to pass, all that seemed wrong was now right, and those who deserved to were certain to live a long and happy life. Ever after.
Ever after.
Journey over, all is mended, and it's not just for today, but tomorrow, and extended, ever after.
Ever after.
All the curses have been ended, the reverses wiped away, all is tenderness and laughter, for forever after.
Happy now and happy hence and happy ever after.
There were dangers and confusion, and the paths would often swerve. There were constant disillusions, but they never lost their nerve,
and they reached the right conclusions.
And we got what we deserve.
No desire, no sorrow, tenderness and laughter. Joy today and bliss tomorrow and forever after.
I was greedy, I was vain, I was haughty, I was smug, we were happy. It was fun, we were blind, and we went into the woods to get our wish, and now we're really blind.
I was perfect, I had everything but beauty, I had power, and I darted like a flower in a tower. Then I went into the woods to get my wish, and now I'm ordinary. Cause I'm a fella, I'm a fella, I'm an happy now, I'm happy as a man's ever after. Happy without power, that's been worthy of our gifts.
Careful, don't be clever, when you see your wish pursue, it's a dangerous endeavor, but the only thing to do.
That was painful,
that
was deep, that was dark, and though you may lose the path that you may come to fall, you must understand, you must touch where you must go farther.
You must understand, 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 you must wish, you must wish, you wish, you wish,
the woods where nothing's clear, where winter's close and wolves appear. Into the woods and through the fear, you have to take the journey.
So they're all happy ever after, but in the last moments of the first act, we see a new beanstalk rising up to the sky from that last bean that Cinderella tossed down. And so now we come to the second half of the show and what the show is really about, which is, once you get your happy ending, what do you do?
Once upon a time, later.
I
wish.
In that same far-off kingdom,
more than anything,
lived the young princess, the lad Jack,
more than footmen,
I wish. And the baker with his family.
No, I miss.
I wish.
More than anything.
More than the moon.
There, there. I wish to sponsor a festival.
More than life.
I miss.
The time has come for a festival.
More than riches.
And a ball.
I miss my kingdom up in the sky.
More than anything.
I wish we had more room.
But despite some minor inconveniences, they were all quite content.
I never thought I'd wed a prince.
I never thought I'd find perfection.
I never thought I could be so happy.
Not an unhappy moment since.
I didn't think we'd be this rich.
I
never thought we'd have a baby.
I
never thought I could be so happy.
Just as long as you stay happy, we'll stay happy.
Not one round.
Lots of pence.
With my cow.
Little girdles.
Darling, I must go now.
We should really sell it.
Where's the cheesecloth?
Wishes may bring problems such that you regret them. Better that though than to never get them.
I'm going to be a perfect mom.
I'm going to be the perfect son.
I'm going to be a perfect mom.
I'm going to be a perfect mom.
I'm going to see that she is so happy. I never thought I'd love my life. I would have settled for another.
Then to become a wife.
Then to be set for love.
Then to be get a child. Then for to smile. I'm so happy.
Have you done this to our house?
Always thinking of yourself. Look at my garden!
Destroyed?
Who could do such a thing?
Do you think it was a bear?
A bear? Bears are sweet. Besides, you ever see a bear with 40-foot feet?
Dragon, no scorch marks. Usually they're linked.
Manticore.
Imaginary.
Griffin.
Extinct.
Giant.
Possible. Very, very possible.
More than possible, their fears would prove to be well-founded.
Into the woods, it's always when you think at last you're through, and then into the woods you go again to take another journey.
Into the woods, the weather's clear, we've been before, we've gone to clear. Into the woods, away from here.
Into the woods to find the giant.
Into the woods to grandmother's house.
Into the woods, the path is straight, no reason then to hesitate.
Into the woods, it's not so late, it's just another journey. To see what's wrong.
Into the woods to slay the giant.
Into the woods to shield the giant.
To flee the winds.
To find a future.
To shield.
To slay.
To find.
To fix. To hide.
To love.
To battle.
So we see that
trouble.
Even when people get what they want. There's still some things that will prop up. There's even when you get everything that you want, you still have to deal with life. You still have to deal with issues, with things that happen. Unfortunately, most of us don't usually have to deal with that in the form of a angry giantess coming down and stomping on our kingdom in exchange or in retaliation for the death of their husband. Yeah, so in case you hadn't caught it, that's basically what's happening. And you may wonder, where are the princes during all this? Well, it turns out that they have decided to run around and get themselves, well, new wives is the best way to look at it.
High in a tower, like yours was, but higher, a beauty asleep. All round the tower, a thicket of briar, 100 feet deep. Agony, no frustration more keen. When the one thing you want is a thing that you've not even seen.
I found a casket entirely of glass. No, it's unbreakable. Inside, don't ask it, a maiden, alas, just as unwakeable. What unmistakable agony is the way always marred. She has skin white as snow. Did you learn her name? No, there's a dwarf standing guard. Agony, such that princes must weep. Always enthralled, most to anything, almost, or something asleep. If it were not for the thicket, a thicket's no trick, is it thicket? The thickest, the quickest is picket, apart with a stick. Yes, but even when prick, it's my thing about blood, well, it's sick. It's no sicker than your thing with dwarves.
Dwarves!
Dwarves! Dwarves are very upsetting, not forgetting the task's unachievable, mountains unscalable, if it's conceivable, but unavailable.
Agony,
misery,
woe not to know what you miss.
While they lie there for years,
and you cry on their beers,
what unbearable bliss.
Agony, that can cut like a knife.
Ah, well, back to my wife.
Just so you know, that scream that you heard at the beginning of the, or at the end of the first song, was, of course, Rapunzel. Apparently, she's been having a hysterical fit, which is part of the reason that her prince is out trying to find another. Now, sorry, lost my place. At this point, we get treated to quite a bit of the giant is rampaging through the woods and through the kingdom itself. We see a number of people who are leaving the kingdom essentially as refugees, trying to get out of the path of the giant. Number of people get killed, mostly pretty much entirely minor characters, including, however, Rapunzel. Rapunzel just gets crushed as the giantess attempts to find Jack. And soon after she gets crushed, the witch comes upon her and can only weep over the loss of her daughter.
This is the world I meant. Couldn't you listen? Couldn't you stay content? Safe behind walls as
And this is a song that's going to come back, at least the sentiment of the song is going to come back a little bit later, towards the end of the show. But here, it's the statement of children won't listen is put out very much as a curse. It's anger. You know, the witch has lost the person who is most important to her, the person that she loves the most in her life. And the only thing that she can see that caused that loss is that Rapunzel wouldn't listen to her. She sees nothing else that caused it, except for that. So, in her mind, all of the fault lies with Rapunzel not heeding her words, not heeding her advice. And again, you know, looking at it, this is, if you're looking at it in modern terms, this is a classic toxic relationship. The witch is basically a stereotypical abusive parent. Really, that's the only way to interpret that. Anyways, as the exodus from the kingdom continues, the baker stumbles across the royal family and tries to convince them to stay. The witch says that she will find Jack and sacrifice him to the giant, and the baker and his wife decide that they've got to find him first, and they split up and try to find Jack. However, the baker's wife soon finds somebody that she was not expecting to, somebody who had previously taken notice of her, despite her low station. Although we have seen that he has a bit of a thing for lower class girls.
Anything can happen in the woods. May I kiss you? Any moment we could be crushed. Don't feel rushed.
This is ridiculous. What am I doing here? I'm in the wrong story. Wait one moment, please. We can't do this.
Of course, you're right. How foolish. Foolishness can happen in the woods. Once again, please, let your hesitations be hushed. Any moment, big or small, is a moment. After all, seize the moment. Skies may fall any moment. Days are made of moments, all are worth exploring. Many kinds of moments, none is worth ignoring. All we have are moments, memories for storing. One would be so boring.
But this is not right.
Right and wrong don't matter in the woods. Only feelings let us meet the moment unblushed. Life is often so unpleasant. You must know that as a peasant, best to take the moment present as a present for the moment. I must leave you.
Why?
The giant.
Will we find each other in the woods again?
This was just a moment in the woods, our moment, shimmering and lovely and sad. Leave the moment, just be glad for the moment that we had. Every moment is a moment when you're in the woods. Goodbye.
What was that? Was that me? Was that him? Did a prince really kiss me? And kiss me? And kiss me? And did I kiss him back? Was it wrong? Am I mad? Is that all? Does he miss me? Was he suddenly getting bored with me? Wake up! Stop dreaming! Stop prancing about the woods! It's not beseeming, what is it about the woods? Back to life, back to sense, back to child, back to husband, you can't live in the woods.
There are vows, there are ties, there are needs, there are standards, there are shouldn'ts and shoulds. Why not both instead? There's the answer if you're clever. Have a child for warmth and a baker for bread and a prince for whatever. Never, it's these woods. Face the facts, find the boy, join the group, stop the giant, just get out of these woods. Was that him? Yes, it was. Was that me? No, it wasn't just a trick of the woods. Just a moment, one peculiar passing moment. Must it all be either less or more, either plain or grand? Is it always or is it never? And that's what woods are for those moments in the woods. Oh, if life were made of moments, even now and then a bad one. But if life were only moments, then you'd never know you had one. First a witch, then a child, then a prince, then a moment. Who can live in the woods? And to get what you wish only just for a moment, these are dangerous woods. Let the moment go. Don't forget it for a moment, though. Just remembering you've had an and when you're back to or makes the or mean more than it did before. Now I understand, and it's time to leave the woods.
It's kind of interesting that the baker's wife reaches this state of almost enlightenment at the end of that song, coming to the realization that she, that by experiencing this moment, by experiencing this infidelity, by experiencing this slight moral compromise that she very clearly is not going to tell her husband about when she runs back into him, is something that made her realize, you know, all these things that I wanted, maybe I don't really need them, because I've seen what this guy really is. You know, I envied Cinderella for getting the prince and getting the gowns and everything, but now I saw what he's like. You know, if he could throw their commitment aside so easily for me, then that would have been me if I'd been her. And I actually do appreciate the guy who I'm with, who's, you know, this stable family, this stable life that I have. Unfortunately, as seems to be the case with most stories like this, as soon as she reaches this level of enlightenment, she dies. Yes, in the next moments, the giantess manages to find her, or see her as she's walking across the woods, and crushes her. Now, the baker, Little Red Riding Hood, and Cinderella are awaiting the return of the wife when the witch appears, dragging in Jack, who she found weeping over the wife's body. Once the baker finds out about the wife's death, he agrees to throw Jack to the giantess as the witch wants to, and this leads into all of the characters yelling at each other about who it is that's actually to blame for all of this stuff that's happening to them.
It's because of you there's a giant in our midst and my wife is dead.
But it isn't my fault. I was given those beans. You persuaded me to trade away my cow for beans, and without those beans, there'd have been no stock to get up to the giants in the first place.
Wait a minute, magic beans for a cow so old that you had to tell a lie to sell it, which you told. Were they worthless beans? Were they oversold? Oh, and tell us who persuaded you to steal that gold.
See, it's your fault.
No.
So it's your fault.
No.
Yes, it is.
It's not.
It's true.
Wait a minute, but I only stole the gold to get my cow back from you.
So it's your fault.
Yes.
No, it isn't. I'd have kept those beans, but our house was cursed. She made us get a cow to get the curse reversed.
It's your father's fault that the curse got placed and the place got cursed in the first place.
Oh, then it's his fault.
It was his fault.
No.
Yes, it is. It's his.
I guess.
Wait a minute, though. I chopped down the beanstalk, right? That's clear. But without any beanstalk, then what's queer is how did the second giant get down here in the first place? Second place.
Yeah, how?
Well, who had the other bean?
The other bean.
The other bean.
You pocketed the other bean.
I didn't. Yes, I did.
So it's yours.
No, it isn't, because I gave it to my wife.
So it's hers.
No, it isn't.
Then whose is it?
Wait a minute, she exchanged that bean to obtain your shoe, so the one who knows what happened to the bean is you.
You mean that old bean that your wife, oh dear, but I never knew, and so I do, but don't look here.
So it's your fault.
See, it's her fault, and it isn't mine at all.
But what? Well, if you hadn't gone back up again.
We were needy.
You were greedy, did you need that head?
But I got it from my mother.
So it's her fault, then.
Yes, but what about the harp in the third place?
The harp, yes. Wait, you dare me to.
I dared you to?
You dared me to, she said that I was scared to. She dared.
No, I
so
didn't.
So it's your fault.
Wait a minute.
You hadn't dared him to.
And you had left the harp alone, it wouldn't
be in
trouble
in the first place. Get your prince, had to get your cow, have to get your wish, doesn't matter how, anyway it doesn't matter now. It's the last midnight, it's the boom splat, nothing but a last midnight, everybody smashed flat. Nothing we can do, not exactly true, we can always give her the boy. No, no, of course what really matters is the blame. Somebody to blame. Fine, if that's the thing you enjoy, placing the blame. If that's the aim, give me the blame. Just give me the boy.
No.
No. You're so nice. You're not good, you're not bad, you're just nice. I'm not good, I'm not nice, I'm just right. I'm the witch, you're the world. I'm the hitch, I'm what no one believes. I'm the witch, you're all liars and thieves. Like his father, like his son will be too. Oh, why bother? You'll just do what you do as the at you fast midnight. Soon you'll see the sky fall. Here you want a bean, have another bean. Beans were made for making you rich. Plant them and they soar. Here you want some more. Listen to the roar, giants by the score. Well, you can blame another witch. It's the last midnight, it's the last verse. Now before it's past midnight, I'm leaving you my last curse. I'm leaving you alone. You can tend the garden, it's yours, separate and alone. Everybody down on all fours. All right, mother, when lost the beans again, punish me the way you did then. Give me claws and a hunt, just away from this bunch. And the gloom, and the doom, and the boom.
And with that final curse, that final cry, the witch turns herself into something, I don't know, causes herself to disappear somehow and vanishes. The baker... Sorry, I was about to start in on the next synopsis, but I just want to sit on those songs for a moment. Your Fault and Last Midnight. Your Fault is... I think it's kind of it's supposed to be the flip side of the main theme of the show, because the main theme of the show is, what do you do when you get what you want? You know, what, how does that affect you? How does it change you? How do you know what it is that you want? And but then the other side of that is, when you don't get what you want, then obviously something has gone wrong. And when something's gone wrong, what's the reason for that? And what everyone is not realizing in that show, in that moment, is that all of them are to blame. That all of them wanting what they have wanted, trying to get what they've wanted over the course of the first part of this show, is what's led them to this moment. The only one who realizes that is the witch, and as she says, I'm not good, I'm not nice, I'm just right. She's right. She's right that giving the giantess Jack would stop everything, but none of them want to do that because they're too nice. And it's always interesting to see to see evil characters portrayed more sympathetically. It's one of the reasons that I like this version of the witch from Rapunzel much better than the version that was in like the Disney movie of Rapunzel, because she had no, you know, other versions are just so kind of transparently evil, whereas this one, you know, she's got motivation, she's got drive, she's got a whole character going on, obviously, but it's just more understandable why she does the things that she does. All right, but anyways, going forward, the baker is grieving, obviously, over the loss of his wife, and he runs away trying to basically flee from his responsibilities, but he realizes that he can't, and that he's got to go back.
No more questions, please. No more tests. Comes the day you say what for, please, no more.
They disappoint, they disappear, they die, but they don't.
What?
They disappoint, in turn I fear, forgive though they won't.
No more riddles, no more jests. No more curses you can't undo, left by fathers you never knew. No more quests, no more feelings. Time to shut the door. Just no more.
Running away, let's do it. Free from the ties that bind. No more despair or burdens to bear out there in the yonder. Running away, go to it. Where did you have in mind? Have to take care, unless there's a where, you'll only be wandering blind. Just more questions, different kind. Where are we to go? Where are we ever to go? Running away, we'll do it. Why sit around resigned? Trouble is some, the farther you run, the more you feel undefined. For what you have left undone, and more, what you've left behind. We disappoint, we leave a mess, we die, but we don't.
We disappoint, in turn, I guess, forget though we won't. Like father, like son. No more giants waging war. Can't we just pursue our lives with our children and our wives? Till that happy day arrives, how do you ignore all the witches, all the curses, all the wolves, all the lies, the false hopes, the goodbyes, the reverses, all the wondering what even worse is still in store? All the children,
all the giants. No more.
And here we had the baker confronting the thing that he's been the most afraid of for the whole show, which is the idea that he would eventually become his father. The idea that he would eventually do the same things that his father did, and he almost did them. He almost ran out on his child, on the people who were relying on him at the end of the story. But he realized, it's kind of beautiful in a way that he realizes that, no, this is what I need to do. I need to go back. I need to not be him. I need to not disappoint. And in the moments before the troop tries to confront the giantess and tries to ensure their safety for the future, it falls upon the baker and Cinderella to comfort and guide the two children who have both lost the most important people to them. While they have lost the most important people to them, the baker with his wife being crushed, and Cinderella discovering that her husband, is Prince Charming.
Mother cannot guide you. Now you're on your own. Only me beside you. Still you're not alone. No one is alone. Truly, no one is alone. Sometimes people leave you. Halfway through the wood, others may deceive you. You decide what's good. You decide alone, but no one is alone.
I wish.
I know. Mother isn't here now.
Wrong things, right things.
Who knows what she'd say?
Who can say what's true?
Nothing's quite so clear now.
Do things, fight things.
Feel you've lost your way.
You decide, but you are
not alone. Believe me, no one is alone.
No one is alone, believe me.
Truly, you move just a finger. Say the slightest word, something's bound to linger. Be heard.
No one acts alone. Careful, no one is alone.
People make mistakes.
Fathers,
mothers,
people make mistakes.
Holding to their own, thinking they're alone.
Honor their mistakes.
Fight for their mistakes.
Everybody makes
one another's terrible mistakes.
Witches can be right.
Giants can be good.
You decide what's right.
You decide what's good.
Just remember,
someone is on your side.
Our side.
Someone else is not.
While we're seeing our side,
maybe we forgot. They are not alone. No just don't let it go.
Things will come out right now. We can make it so. Someone is on your side. No one is alone.
The lyrics there say that they get interrupted, and I know that they do because I've seen the show multiple times, but I was just waiting to see if there was going to be some kind of a crash that I needed to adjust the volume for. I'd been not been hitting that the last few times, and I didn't want to have a, you know, giant noise come over the airwaves and scare everybody. But that, again, I feel like I'm saying that all the time as I'm playing this stuff. One of my favorite songs. It's taking the whole theme of what is it that you want? What is it that you are getting what you want, trying to achieve what it is you want, and looking past it, saying it's not what you want, it's who you're with. It's not what you desire, it's who's going to be around you and who's going to be there when the things that you desire fall through. When you can't achieve your goals, how are you going to live? Who are you going to live with? I don't know. I feel like I feel like I'm rambling nonsensically when I do this. But anyways, the four remaining main characters slay the giant, and the deceased characters, including the royal family and the princes, return to give the final lesson of morals to the audience as they get ready to leave. And of course, we get to see Snow White and Sleeping Beauty come out as the princes, as the two charming princes' latest somnambulist conquests.
The slotted spoon can catch the potato.
Every knot was once straight rope.
The harder to wait, the better to have.
The greater the good, the harder the blow.
When going to hide, know how to get there.
And how to get back.
And eat first.
The knife that is sharp today may be dull by tomorrow.
Maybe I just wasn't meant to have children.
Don't say that. Of course you were meant to have children.
How can I go about being a father with no one to mother my child?
Just calm the child.
Yes, calm the child.
Look, tell him the story of how it all happened. Be father and mother, you'll know what to do.
Alone.
Sometimes people leave you halfway through the wood. Do not let it grieve you. No one leaves for good. You are not alone. Let him see the glow. Things will be all right now. Tell him what you know.
Once upon a time, a far-off kingdom, there lived a young maiden.
Careful the things
young
you
lad.
Say. Children
child
will listen. Careful the things you do. Children will see and learn. Children may not obey, but children will listen. Children will look to you for which way to turn. Before you say, listen to me.
see a glimmer.
Into the woods you have to go, but that's the way you learn to cope. Into the woods to find this hope of getting through the journey. Into the woods each time you go, there's more to learn of what you know. Into the woods the mountain slow, into the woods it's nearing midnight. Into the woods to mind the wolf, to heed the witch, to honor the giant, to mind, to hate, to find, to think, to taste, to try, to go to the festival. Into the woods! Into the woods!
And at the end of the show, with everyone having either died, in the case of everybody but the four main characters who were on the stage at the end, or gotten at least partially what they want, we still have Cinderella wishing, wanting more. And, excuse me, I know that I mentioned it before, but this is where the song that the witch was singing during her lament comes back. The idea of, you know, children will listen. But it takes on such a different tone in this part, because before it was children, you know, it was children won't listen. It was children will, you know, do what they're gonna do. Children are going to hurt you, therefore don't have children, basically seemed to be the way that the witch was going, or what the witch was saying. But here it came across much more as you need to be careful, because they will listen, because children are going to absorb everything that it is that you, everything that you put out there, anything that you say to children, that you say around them, they're going to hear, and everything that you don't say, they're going to hear, and they're going to internalize, and they're going to, it's going to become a part of them. And it's really interesting to look at that and to look back at the line from West Side Story last week, where Doc, the drugstore owner, says to the members of the Jets, you know, you kids make this world lousy. And the Jets member looks back at him and says, we didn't make the world, or we didn't make it. It's an interesting theme that seems to come back in a number of Sondheim's musicals, and an interesting thing to leave on. So that's going to be it for Broadway Friday today. Join me next week for the final installment of September Sondheim. I'm sorry, I'm tripping over my own teeth and tongues here. When we are going to be getting into what is undoubtedly my favorite show ever, more than Hamilton, more than anything else. When I see it done live, and I see it done live well, it is a joy in my heart, and I'm going to be looking forward to sharing with you all just a little bit of Priest. So this is DJ Eric. Have a great day.